Since 1991, ProTaper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, ProTaper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more.
Everyone, good morning and welcome to the Kickstart podcast presented by ProTaper. It's a Monday after a busy weekend for myself, at least. I know Anton had some action going. A-Ray did as well. I'm not sure what Chase did. Oh, he got inked up. But
Chase is partying. Chase is partying this week.
Yep. Halloween party Saturday is super cool.
What'd you go as?
We have ads at the beginning of this video, right?
Ads?
Yeah, like because in YouTube you're not supposed to say certain words for the first minute, otherwise you get flagged.
Yeah.
Probably there now, but I was a UPS guy with a dick in a box, basically. It was pretty sick.
It's pretty good.
Mm.
Nice. Heck yeah.
Oh, it is almost Halloween, huh? Halloween's this Thursday?
Thursday.
Yep. Thursday, yeah.
Dude, yeah. That's crazy, man. Pat and I are flying to Huntsville, Alabama tomorrow to go ride a new Dunlop tire at their testing facility. And it's the tire that Eli just won the Canadian GP with, I believe.
I hear you guys are doing some Supercross riding.
Yeah, Pat's doing some Supercross riding.
That'd be awesome.
Yeah.
Wait, I heard, are you sure it's that tire? Because I'm glad that you mentioned the Eli tire, but I heard the tire you're riding is a different tire.
Is it? I don't know. I'm just putting two and two together, right? Because it's a new spec tire that we're going to get to ride that's going to be for sale.
But okay.
When I was walking to the pits this weekend, I was with Greg Herbold, you know, H-Ball, the crazy mountain biker that's part of the Tomac crew. And I was all, dude, how about Hole Shot Boy? And he goes, it's the tire, man. It's that new tire. It's the new Dunlop tire. So I thought, oh, maybe it's the one that we're riding.
Okay, so I'm glad that you mentioned that because I was looking at your pictures from the weekend. I think he's running that off-road tire that's the directional where you can spin it the other way and it's got the V.
AT82.
The tire that you're supposed to test tomorrow, I heard all about it this weekend. It's actually, so when they did the factory editions last year for KTM, these tires were supposed to come on those KTMs. They were supposed to be spec Dunlops just like the pro guys run.
Mm-hmm.
But then for whatever reason, they didn't get them fitted to the bikes in time. So Dunlop and KTM made all of these spec tires that have just been sitting somewhere for a while. Wow. So now they're going to sell these through the KTM Power Parts catalog, but they're the spec tires that the Supercross guys can run. Like this is what the top guys are getting when they go to the Dunlop truck every weekend. But then there's a limited quantity of these. So this is a super, super limited thing. So if you have a disposable income and you're willing to just have a good race tire for a weekend, that's what you guys are going to get to go ride.
Yeah.
Nice,
but yeah, Eli being on that 82.
That makes sense because H ball is all, it's a new tire, it's a new tire, and I'm all, oh, and he's all, it's production tire. That's all I'll say. And then
yeah,
forgot to look at it because I saw that it was flat. He had a flat tire, right? And then I started talking to Eli, and he was in such a good mood and giving such a good interview that I didn't think to look at the tire and see what it was. But that makes sense because the AT82 is just like a mellowed down scoop, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, run one way, it's good for soft, and the other way, it's good for hard. But when we did that SRA Grand Prix in January or February, it was also like the intro. Dude, I ran the front and rear on my Stark for probably 3-4 months. So it doesn't wear out either. And the front tire is really good. I guess Plessinger rode the front tire during Supercross.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Huh. Have any of you guys ever rode with the spec tire before?
Yeah, several times. The worst experience I've had with a spec tire is it was actually a spec Pirelli tire. And they came and tested with Pat Foster and I at LA County. They didn't say it was a spec tire, though. They said it was the new tire. And Pat and I were super impressed with it. And we both came back to LA County a couple days later and rode a Grand Prix. And I rode two different Grand Prix and Pat rode two as well. And obviously he's hard on the throttle, but I had like 5 knobbies missing and he had 11 missing.
Oh my God.
These have to be spec tires. So
Yeah. I remember I raced Phoenix Supercross 1 year. It was 2019, whenever I rode for HGP. We got spec tires on that team, like spec Dunlop tires. And I mean, dude, I had a fresh, you know, Dunlop tire on the rear of the bike at the beginning of the main event. And by the end of the main event, there was no knobbies on the thing. Like none. It's nuts. Like, it's so crazy to me how, which I mean, this was like a one race tire. I'm not sure on what they're, you know, Dunlop's going to be selling, obviously, which I'm sure if they're selling it, it's going to last a little bit longer, you know? No, it's not. Oh, one race.
It is a spec tire. Yeah. It is a spec tire that, like, if you are getting this, like, you know, like, hey, I am buying this thing because I have X income. I have this factory edition that I want to make super, super dulled out. I'm a B class, A class guy that's looking for whatever little competitive edge that I have. And yeah, that's what it's supposed to be. The cool thing about it is, and like, A-Ray, you've probably seen this, and Don, I know you have too. Hoosier really did set the tone in the last couple of years. I mean, it didn't work out for Hoosier per se, because that company went through some changes and all the timing of that might not have been ideal. But I think that that showed, especially for a you know, very small brand in motorcycle riding, but huge in motorsport. The fact that they made a tire that was like, this is only good for today. Make sure you get it today. And they sold the shit out of them, especially to high profile amateur kids that aren't sponsored. This Dunlop thing is a cool deal to know, like, yo, do people have money or going to buy the stuff?
Mm-hmm. And like, and I'll just say this, you know, just speaking from experience, a spec tire is like something that you've never rode with before. It's like you're glued to the ground. You feel so confident. Like it's a game changer. Definitely. Like compared to a production style tire that feels a little bit stiffer. Like you feel, you know, like, hey, like you have the grip, but it still slides a bit. So like whenever you go to a, say like a Dunlop spec tire or any different tire, there's no slippage. Like you just feel connected to the ground at all times. You can do things, you can go places and feel more confident in areas where you wouldn't be able to, you know, like on flat turns and stuff like that. And hell, half the time, even whenever you're missing knobbies, it still, you know, works or feels better than, you know, a traditional standard tire.
Do you think a spec tire, Alex, makes a difference for a just knobs like normal guys? I think it's only
I mean,
it and the pro thing.
I think that depending on your skill level, you know, if you're a decent intermediate guy, you know, or, you know, like a decent bet rider, even, you know, even that sort, I think you'll still be able to feel a difference, you know? But at this, it wouldn't be as substantial, I guess, as say like a pro guy or someone who really like geeks out on the stuff and can really feel, you know, certain areas of the track.
Yeah, this feedback's coming from a guy who doesn't check his fork pressure or tire pressure.
Hey, you're right. You're definitely right. Which I'm a soul guy now, right? Like whenever I go to the track, I want to unload my bike, I want to ride my laps, and I want to load up and I want to go home. You know what I mean? I don't want to like unload my bike because I get there late. You know, I always get to the track late. So like unload my bike, fork pressure's down. Like I want to get out and ride. You know, I don't want to be able to check the air pressure. You know, I want that stuff to already just be dialed in, you know?
Mm.
So I did go to LACR
for you.
What's that?
That's what Sam should be doing for you. She's shooting video for you already. She could check your tires.
Yeah, I know. I don't want to put too much strain on her, you know. She's
gotta learn though. What's going to happen when you're on the road and then she's got to take the little one out to these mini bike rides and she's got to check that 50 tire pressure.
Yep.
You're exactly right there. Mm-hmm. But I did go to LACR yesterday and I parked next to some awesome guys. They own like a HVAC company in like San Bernardino. So I parked next to those guys, talked to them, real nice guys. They helped me out with fork and tire pressure yesterday. Yep. They hooked me up. Huh?
Did you notice a difference with the forks?
I did notice a little bit of a difference. Yes, obviously they did feel better, but at the same time, it's like, I hate unloading my bike and the thing looking like it's just.
That's because you don't check your fork pressure, bro.
I pumped them up. I had too much air in them whenever I got there. They took air pressure out, I swear.
All right.
I swear.
All
right. Yeah.
But they were stuck down when you unloaded it?
Yep.
Something's wrong with your bike. You need to take that.
I mean, hey, well, I just talked to the KTM factory, dude. I don't know. It came straight from you guys. So if it's got a leaky fork seal or something, I don't know. But that's, yeah.
We'll have Yellow Magic ready for you soon.
Heck yeah.
Avery, I rewatched that video that you sent us of you just burning laps at LACR. I'm surprised the fam, like the Barbacovi family, didn't charge you extra on the way out for all that dirt you moved off the berms. You were
Oh,
ripping.
dude, yeah. I don't know.
A lot of
I had
flying
some fun
dirt.
yesterday. I had some fun yesterday. I had to reel it in because, like, I thought there was a guy, like, I don't know. Like, I passed a guy and he revved at me. And I'm like, come on, dude. I gave you enough room, all this stuff. I even wore mismatched gear so people, like, wouldn't, like, I don't know, just mess with me. Like, just like, oh, this guy's out here soul riding. So, like, a guy, like, revved at me and it, I kind of, like, seen red for a sec. And, like, I almost had just fucking ruined my day. Just almost ended it right there. But,
Didn't your racers wear mixed match gear this weekend too?
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah. So,
So, were you wearing a Ray 14 jersey though?
yeah, I did say my name and number on there. So, like,
A jersey with nothing on it.
I know I need to get a jersey that has nothing on it. I'm learning my lessons here. You know, I'm just out there trying to ride, just trying to just do my laps.
So now
Dude,
you got 2 days of training for the Finland Supercross under your belt.
nice.
Yeah, more than that. I've been running. I've been running in the morning. I run every other day. I do like 3 miles every other day.
Oh, it's impressive.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm still big though. I'm still large.
Okay, so now obviously you've dropped the news on Instagram. So I'm gonna actually cut in the part from last week's podcast that we had to cut out.
Meanwhile.
Yeah, so I got my freaking pregnant wife up at the ass crack of dawn, which is
Whoa, whoa, whoa.
not
Are we
easy to
public on
do.
the art? You're just gonna drop it like that? My God.
That's what you're gonna say?
What?
You haven't even announced
You
it.
haven't said it.
What did I say?
Dog, the
Pregnant
P word.
wife. Oh, can we go back on that? Or no?
Bad. Okay.
4 to 6 days later.
So just let's make the announcement. A Ray's gonna be a daddy.
Yeah, I'm gonna be dad. Dude, it's nuts. Like, two kids having kids, you know? But no, I'm super excited. You know, it was all, you know, it definitely wasn't planned, you know, with Sam and I, but it's freaking awesome. We're taking it head on and we're excited, man. So yeah, we're having a little baby freaking boy, you know, beautiful, magical. She'll be 16 weeks. She's 16 weeks, I think, right now. The baby's huge. I think it's like the size of a dill pickle, you know, from like the app that I have on my phone. But yeah, baby's growing and yeah, happy, healthy baby, hopefully. So yeah, we're excited.
And you already have a name picked out.
No, yes, no, maybe. I don't know. I don't know. There's a couple there, you know. So pretty much like me and both my sisters, like all of our names like start with A. So like both my sisters, Amber, Amanda, and me, Alex. And I was the only boy, and like my sisters, like it was their nickname first to be A Ray, you know, like that's what everybody called them, you know, and that's what everybody called all of us, A Ray, A Ray. And like I feel like, you know, if I'm having a boy, I kind of want to like keep that rolling, you know, just for like our little family. So I don't know. We're looking at A names. We like a few. So I don't know. We'll see. Yeah.
A names. Maybe we should make a petition for some suggestions in the comment section.
Oh God. Yeah. Definitely not gonna be Alex. But yeah, no, I'm stoked, you know. It's a big change, you know. I mean, Sam kind of wishes that we would have made it to at least, you know, our 1 year anniversary, which is in like 2 weeks, you know. But I mean, you know, better. Yeah, I mean, I you get what you get, you don't throw a fit, you know what I mean? I'm just stoked that we're freaking having a, you know, baby boy. Hopefully he's healthy. And yeah, I'm stoked, you know. Got to get the P-Dub ready, got to get the freaking golf clubs ready. Like, I don't know. Like, do we want him to play golf? Do we want him to race dirt bikes? I'm leaning more towards golf, but you never know. Yeah. Either way, I'll be stoked.
Yeah, a lot of guys say, "Oh no, my kid's playing golf or this or that," and then, I mean, look at Nick Way and Josh Grant, right? They're in deep.
Yeah. No, I went home not that long ago because like my family had like a race at Powerline, and my little nephew, he likes to ride, you know, the P dub around the yard and everything. And he wanted to ride. And my sister was like, no, not today. Like, no. And he was just like, had like the cutest little like frown on his face. Like how can you tell like a little kid? No. Right. So I don't know. It's going to be tough. You know, if he wants to ride motorcycles, you know, he's going to be around it obviously with me, mm-hmm. you know? So yeah, it's going to be tough to say no to riding a dirt bike. That's for sure.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
But Ronnie's excited.
Ronnie's stoked. Ronnie's stoked. My mom's stoked. Sam's family's excited. Everything's going good so far. So everything's.
So he'll be, will he be 1/4 Japanese or 1/8?
Sam's a quarter. So he'll be an eighth. He'll be an eighth. Okay. He'll be a quarter Mexican.
Dude, he's going to check all the boxes on that college application. Yeah. You took a page right out of Pilo's book.
Straight up. You know what I mean? Yep. Yeah. So.
All right. Yeah. So let's get into the weekend. World Supercross, WSX.
Canadian GP.
Canadian Grand Prix kicked off this weekend in BC Place. Yeah, it'd been a little while since I'd been to a race. I'm like, wow, it's only like 2.5-3 hour flight. Let's go. You know, there's some people that we help in the pits. So got there that way. It was a cool event. It was way different. It felt just like an international supercross that, you know, like that I've been to before. You know, like I want to say the first international supercross I went to was the Geneva Supercross. Oh gosh, when Damon Huffman and Jeff Emig were racing and stuff. But it felt kind of the same, you know, with the whole limited entries, the 7 teams and what is it, 38, 28 riders or something. It's kind of a small deal. And Ari, I know when you went and raced for HEP, I remember you were showing me pictures of the little pit areas and everything and the little rooms. Like, so yeah, in the arena, it was just like these locker rooms, and they had, I think one room was Firepower and MCR, the other was HEP and Rick Ware, and then CDR and the other Yamaha team were in the alley. But I actually never went and found the room that Cade was in, so that must have been the other two teams.
Oh yeah, that was like the wild cards, right? Because Cade was only a wild card.
Yeah, but like, yeah, I never. Yeah, I don't know, but anyway, it was confusing, dude. It was a really loose show. It was things changed constantly as far as like the way the program was run and stuff. Like on Friday, there was supposed to be a press day at 12, and I had some snafus with the rental car and everything, so I got into the stadium around 12:15, and I was freaking out that I was missing the rider interview portion and everything. And I walked in, and Max Anstey's walking off the track, and I was like, "Hey, Max, did I miss all the interviews? Press day over?" And he goes, "Oh, it's a shit show," because it's so unorganized. He goes, "I went out on the track for this riders meeting. There's not one person out there, not even like any track workers." So it was really loose. I just ended up running around talking to people in the locker rooms and stuff. But they were originally not gonna grant us any track access for photos on race day, but on press day they said we could. But it was this like gated off area. It was like 12 feet by 10 feet maybe, and they wanted everyone to stand there. So I was like, yeah, this is no good, because a lot of people were complying. So I went and stood on top of a box in the corner of the stadium and filmed there. But it was cool. I had a good time. The dirt was super crazy. It was that gray stuff. You guys saw it. Did you guys watch on TV or see the photos and stuff? Oh,
we definitely heard about the glacial till.
Yeah.
They love to mention that.
Yeah, dude, the ruts wash, corduroy, right? Was so tight. That's a good word. Emick was calling the ruts corduroy. Instead of ruts, it's just the dirt's all corduroy right now. Mm. Never heard that before. It was pretty good, though.
Yeah. It was weird because I filmed. Yeah, I didn't shoot any photos on practice day because it was where we could stand stuff. So I stood on these boxes and other people were walking on it. So it was kind of shaking me and everything. But It was funny because I ended up filming it and just putting out the raw video. And all these people were like, yo, dude, what's up with your color correction, man? You're putting some crazy emo shit on here, making and some dumb guy's all, it hurt my eyes. Like, how does fucking a video hurt your eyes? But it was
Dull dirt.
really just the freaking dirt, right? This gray dirt made everything look weird and the strange light in there. But like, remember that? Do you guys remember that movie Sin City? That was a whole thing was gray tone, except the colors that they wanted were colored, kind of like the Dirt Shark videos. But yeah, that's what it looked like at first. It was bizarre.
Those orange boxes really threw the contrast off, like the gray dirt and then the rest of the building, and then just big orange blocks really made it look screwy.
Yeah, and the dirt had so many rocks, it was so soft and everything. It was burly.
It looked like a very, very similar dirt to Seattle 2017, I would say. Like it was very similar, with the rocks and with how like sandy and silty it was, and how much like it rutted up, It kept the guys on their toes, man. Like we've seen Cody Shock, he got cross-rutted, hit a rock there and shot left. Seeing him get a little sketchy in the whoops as well.
Rock hit a rock.
Yeah, I
Rock
mean
hit
a
a
lot of
rock.
people had issues. I mean, I think the only person who didn't have any issues was Eli. He seemed like he was just right at home, just doing his deal out front, the track, it looked like it was built well, was it standard Dirtworks guys, the same guys as do Supercross?
No.
I don't think
No,
so.
it was
I think
different.
it's the Jetworks guys.
Yeah, and then
Gotcha.
Noah Viney's dad helped out and stuff too.
I heard that like all the spacing, the track, like everything was good and built well. It was just a matter of, the dirt. And one thing I did hear a lot of like criticism just on how fast everything went once the racing started, a lot of the riders were wanting a little bit more extra time to get loaded in the gate.
Yeah, the each class had three motos, right? Two 8 lap motos, but it was like 8 laps, 5 minutes to reload the gate, 8 laps again. It was pretty
Yeah,
gnarly.
I wonder why they wouldn't do 258 laps, then 48 laps. Like the poor guy,
Yeah.
no break. That's crazy.
Yeah, it was pretty bizarre. And it's like if you think about it, if there was a mechanical, there's no time
Yeah,
to fix
no.
anything, right? And it's not like their guys are gonna send two bikes and shit and the in the crates, but
When I went a couple years ago to like those first two in 22, and it was the same thing where it was just bang, 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 one class and then another. I think the reason that they said that they were trying to do that was not to confuse people because they know that they're not going to get a core fan. They're just trying to get like 50-50 split, core fan, 50-50 split. Hey, man, it's just something to do on a Saturday, so come out. So I think bringing a whole new group of people in and then not really having the time or the explanation of these are who these guys are. Just keep sending the same dudes out of repetition and then they'll figure out who they are from there. But I agree with you guys because, like, if you don't know where you're at and you don't know what the results are doing or anything like that, those 5 minutes and three races, like, you never have an idea, especially with the scores being as varied as they are, too.
Yeah, and then it's funny because you talk about people getting confused. I mean, even people are that are hardcore enough to follow us on YouTube, they're like, why was Eli running number one? Like dummies, they don't know that's Max Anstey on 250. But yeah, it was confusing even in person, right? Because the announcers that they had, they did a pretty good job, but there was not one scoreboard in the stadium. Like there's the jumbotrons and they're playing the action and stuff. There was no standings. There was no, like during qualifying and stuff, there was no leaderboard or anything. It's just the only way you knew what people's times were just listening to the announcers. But like during the race, no, there's no call outs on the graphics or anything of who was leading or whatnot. So,
Yeah, on the broadcast, Savacci was leading at some point. Matt Moss was leading at some point. That timing and scoring was a little all over the place too.
Yeah, we got sent an email for what was it called? It was like a live app or something. I forwarded it to you, Chase. Did you see it? It's called Sportity. Yeah, it was like an app that you could watch the results there. But even that, it wasn't necessarily live. It just came up like a couple minutes after the race. But I don't know. Altogether, though, it's pretty cool. It was a good event to go to. Yeah, it was rad seeing Eli and Tomac and Freezy and the other guys up there, but it's like they're gonna need to do something to boost the overall racer quality in the field, I think. Because I mean, I don't know. Like there was dudes out there that were not that good. I guess. I don't know. But dude, Eli was on a tear though. Kenny obviously looked super fast. He made a big deal to point out that he was racing on KYB suspension for the first time, and he only ran it like two or three times. So he was glad to get a race test out of it. But
Is that still, do you know, is it still active ride stuff or is he
yeah, he had
on?
active stickers on it, which
Okay.
is because weird because I looked down because you guys were saying that he was doing the
REP.
REP stuff.
Outdoors on the 2VD, yeah. But I'm just, when he said he switched to KYB, I was like, oh, I wonder if REP is doing his stuff now because I know they're pretty big in KYB right now.
Yeah, but I don't know, it's cool. Yeah, Kenny was on it like during practice and everything, and then oh, that's what was gnarly too is so on race day there's two practice sessions, but the first one is just free practice with no scores put in, and there's just one time session. So after the first time session, Eli said he was pulling off the track and the bike quit and it wouldn't start up again. So they had to change the motors and everything out of the bikes. And he missed like the first half or more of the qualifying session itself.
Oh,
And then
wow.
I was sitting there watching it and I was like, wait, where's Eli? And he came out in like the last 5 minutes. And he put in a he rolled, I think the first two laps, he didn't do all the big rhythms, but then he qualified second quickest pretty quickly. But asked him later, I was like, dude, what is it like to jump on a bike that they just swap the motor and everything? Like, how do you go out and send it on that? Is it nerve-wracking? He goes, you just have to believe in your team.
It's a little bit tougher that with that too, just because they run different gas up there. They have different. It makes the bike run a lot different. So I mean, yeah, it can get a little hairy. I would assume up there.
Yeah, he told me that when they were switching the engine, he's like, yeah. Not worried. I put in some good times in the first one, and then they realized that the first one didn't count. He's like, "Oh shit!" So I wonder, what do you think, Anton? If he had missed that whole second session, would they have done some sort of concession to put him in?
Oh yeah, I mean, because like they need to have every guy, like regardless, because like Supercross is out now because he got hurt, so there's like your first scratch of the night. So I'm sure that they would have him do something, and then with the amount of money that they're spending to make sure that Eli comes to do this, and how important this whole like two greatest of all time, greatest of their era contenders against each other, like Eli's going to be fine. And then if anything, it might make it like a little bit more dynamic, because then you don't know like what the big question of the day is. But then they had the Super Bowl stuff. So did Super Bowl, which we didn't see any of, did that see the gate picks for the first ones, or was that all based off qualifying times?
I think that that's seeded, but what's crazy about that is because like when you watch a guy turning in his burner lap during a qualifying session, you're like, oh yeah, but the noise is all the bikes and everything, right? But watching a guy doing Super Bowl and fucking hit the whoops wide open, it's pretty badass. And it worked, and it went almost. I want to say there was only one guy that wasn't faster than the guy before him. I think it might have been Thompson or something. He didn't take over the time from the guy before him. But like it was like a movie script written out, like, oh, then Tomac's the fast, and then Kenny goes out and he uncorks that triple quad thing, and his fastest qualifier. But and then I was still unclear on it. I have to like look at the race results and stuff, but like there's 5 points awarded for Super Bowl, right? So then that's how Anstey got second overall, even though he kind of like crashed a bunch in the last two races, I think.
I love the Super Bowl thing. It's so good. And like to see, I love just all of it. There's the excitement of like, hey, this guy is good. He can put together a good lap. It's going to be within this. But when all the attention is just on them and you can hear a pin drop everywhere within the stadium, except like you said, Don, with that bike just hitting it, and you actually do get to hear where the guy gets on the power at that you would never get to hear before when it's 22 other bikes on the track, how fast they really are going through some things. Like, you don't have to gas it as hard. And then between Eli, Ken, all the other guys, Dino, Joey, Vince that are there, to hear the power difference in how the bikes sound and then who gets on the gas where, like Eli compared to Kenny.
Yeah, and even hearing like the shock through the whoops and stuff, it's like gives the fan the perspective that we get to see when we go to the test tracks and film and whatnot. It's sick. I love it. I love it.
Yeah, it's kind of lame that it wasn't televised, though. Yeah.
Yeah, that is weird because it was televised last year. I'm not sure, or at least I gave like a quick recap last year, but I'm not sure why they didn't.
Yeah. I like when it's in like intermission, like when it's in the middle of stuff and you already have an idea of like, yo, these are the guys that are out here. Like when they go, well, they'll do it in Paris in a couple of weeks. And when they did it at the World Supercross stuff a few years ago, you had already kind of gotten an idea of who was fast through the first few motos. And then once you get to that, you're like, oh, okay, so this guy could do this line and all of that stuff.
Yeah. I think, Anstey got one Super Bowl, but he didn't do like some combinations and stuff. He went inside and rolled stuff. And it was kind of like, oh, it is faster, you know, the way he does it. But I don't know.
Do you guys think that a little bit of the race got like between Kenny and Eli? Like we seen him battle a little bit. Kenny made a mistake, all of that sort of stuff in one of the main events. But a few of the other ones, it seemed like the race at the front got kind of hindered a bit just because, like, you know, I mean, which it is racing, obviously. But, you know, whenever I would have liked to have seen more of Kenny and Eli, you know, I think that he got stuck behind, you know, a few guys like Vince, and it sort of like hindered from the race. Cause then you look up and then Eli's 20 seconds ahead of everybody, you know, and it sort of just like a snooze fest after that. Well, did you guys like catch any of that or no?
I agree with you, Alex, just at least on TV. Cause yeah. Obviously going in, those are the two guys we want to see battle, and yeah. We got to see some glimpses of it, but for the most part, no, we didn't get to see them really shed paint. Yeah. Or
I would have liked to have seen closer racing with Eli and yeah. Kenny. That's sort of like where I'm at, you know. Which I mean, it's racing; things happen. I get that 100%. But I feel like it sort of did get a little like the gaps were huge, like from first to second, a lot of the time with Eli out front. Which I mean, he is the best guy in that series right now. So, I mean, I feel like that's something that we're
going to. I was kind of wondering if it was going to be like that because, right, you know, a Super Bowl and then the first race. But yeah, Eli was gone those last two. Really, really gone in the third one. I think 22 seconds or something.
Yeah. And those are his conditions too. When the track's nasty, well, actually, it's a little bit softer.
He was saying he was stoked to race here in these conditions because you go, these are the ones I suck and struggle in the most. So I need practice here. And he was pumped.
Yeah.
Pumped on it.
But he's just in such a good mood here lately. I don't know what it is. He's just excited to race, excited to just, it's like, I don't know, man. Like, you know, he, at first, whenever he left Cowie, he was like super excited. And then he kind of got closed off a little bit towards the end. But it seems like since his injury, right, he had a little bit of time apart from the races and everything. And then as soon as he comes back, he's just all smiles, excited to be back. It's almost like a big fresh breath of fresh air, seems like.
He's having fun for sure. I asked him if the you know, the two summers off gave him that appreciation for being away and really missing it. And he said, absolutely, he wants to race.
I think he also knows, though, this is realistically the end. Like, it came up at the nation somewhere in like the press conference or something where they're like, okay, so you could do this and you might keep going to this. And he's like, 25 is it for all of that stuff. I'm not like, that is the last year of Supercross, of motocross, of SMX. We'll see what 26 brings. But I really think that this is like, this is it. And if you are going to end it rather than go off on some like farewell tour to say bye to everybody, the most Tomac thing possible is to go race as hard as you can and go out like on a high note. It's going to be incredible if this really is his last year and he's done two nationals, three SMX races, motocross and nations, these four races that are coming up too. He's going to be so fit and ready to go. How many times do we really see a guy at the end of their career go out at the height of their career like he is right now? And like, even the stuff we said in the first 5 minutes of this thing with the tire and his starts getting this way and all these things that they're doing, they're trying everything. This is not we're just trying to just like fulfill it out one more time. They're going to try to fucking win this one.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. He said, do you guys think, like, after he retires, what type of retired guy is he going to be? Is he going to be a guy that just rides off into the sunset that we never see again? Is he going to be like RV? Is he going to be like Dungy?
He's gone.
He's dude. Just gone.
He's gone. Gone.
He
is gone.
He said that his kids, you know, he's got three kids now. He says they're getting to the age where they're like, yo, dad, why you got to leave? You know, so he's definitely looking forward to being home, I think, full time.
Yep. That's cool.
I like that Kenny just straight up said, like, I didn't have anything for him. And they had good battles. Like, that second moto was a good one. I watched that one just before we got on. And then I love the dynamic that Vince brings into it, too, because it does, like, jumble everything up. It does keep things close. And then to see that everybody had to deal with him and that he raced everybody hard. But then him and Joey really weren't that far off of Ken and Eli for a little bit. Like, as hard as they were going at it for each other, the lead two guys aren't right there. I think Joey looked really, really good, all things considered, right now.
He did.
Yeah. And he was on, like, a different fork, I heard, or something like that. Like, it, you know, his program got, you know, it was kind of late. He hasn't had much testing. And for him to look as good and as comfortable as he did, like, I mean, that's a step in the right direction, I feel like, right?
Yeah, he's only been on that bike, I think, 3 days before racing. And it's funny because he started his time with the team on the 24 bike. And I guess he, like, hated it. Capital letter, hated it. And then he got on the 25 CR450 and is much more comfortable on it. And, 3 days, pretty comfortable. Vince was the only guy on a 25 over at MCR that were in their 24 bikes. Tony Lessie said that there's parts availability issues. And so they went out and bought two bikes. And the funny thing, you know, Tony is crazy. They measure everything, and they have notebooks of data and everything. And so they bought two 25 CR450Rs. And he says that one of them is 10 mil lower in the back than the other. And they can't figure out where. They've measured it from the swing arm, from the fender, this, that. At first, he thought the swing arm or the subframe got crushed in the transport or something, so they got a different subframe. He goes, nope, one's 10 mil off. And I asked Vince about it. He goes, my practice bike feels way different than my race bike. You can feel that. But I don't know. But Vince likes it. He says it's a better starting point and a better race bike than the 24, which is what Ryan Breese rode. But it's funny, man. Like, I looked at the YouTube comments quite a bit this week, and like, in how was your weekend? Somebody's all, dude, why do you even bother interviewing Vince? He shouldn't even be out there. That guy should be retired or whatever, you know. But like, dude, the guy makes main events in American Supercross. That means he's one of the 22 best Supercross racers in the world, you know. Like, just because he has this whole shotting ability that other people wish they could have, you know. I mean, yeah, sometimes he gets a little nutty on the track, but
first two laps in the first main were a little scary.
But I mean, like, you got to have someone like that in the sport, right? Like, if he wasn't there doing the things that he did, we wouldn't have anything to talk about, you know.
Look what my boy Colton did for Endurocross this weekend. Got some heat, but there's a lot of more people watching Endurocross now.
Yeah.
100%. You said that the Firepower guys and the MCR guys were in the same locker room. How was that between Vince and Joey? Holy shit. There were a couple. Like, I was just watching one. Joey has, like, the pass made. And he's like, all right, I'm good. And then he goes into the corner and, you're not. I thought that was great. But then even everything you said, like, yo, Vince is fast. Like, there is no denying how good Vince is. Yeah. And now that this arena cross stuff is out there, that is going to be wild to see, because those arena cross races are nothing like Supercross. Vince is a great Supercross rider. And I'm not saying he can't ride arena cross, but it's completely different. Like, the tracks break down differently. They're not even a quarter of a size. You know what I mean? The dirt's going to be different. Spec of the jumps is going to be different. The format's way different. It's going to be interesting to see how a guy like Vince, like, does jump into it. I'm sure he's done a ton of them, being, you know, a Cape Girardeau, Missouri guy, and there was so many to do. And it's cool to see the rebirth that's happening in arena cross all across the country right now, because that TriStar series looks sick. The kicker one's going to be good. The General Tire one's building always. Like, there's good regional stuff happening, and to see a big guy like Vince, you know, like, yo, I'm going to go jump down here and make it exciting. Like, it's going to get interesting in a few weeks.
Going back to the YouTube comments, or was it Instagram? I don't know. I put up a lap of Vince and I said, yeah, he's coming, going to arena cross next year. Some guy's all, yo, these boys have no idea what's coming. Hope they have their insurance premiums paid up. There's gonna be some broken tib fibs this season.
Yo, hey, if you thought the arena cross fight videos were cool with like B class guys, wait till you see this one. This is gonna be all time next year.
Yep.
Dude, Matt Barkeen's YouTube is gonna freaking just go through the
Pop it.
roof.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, it's gonna be popping off.
You know, what's funny about that is the whole MCR going arena cross. It's Ryan Breese is doing, right? He's like, yo, I made way more here, this and that. So kind of cool. Something interesting, right? I know Supercross fan, internet tough guys. Yeah. Vince is gone. Get him out of here. But,
You know, on like the note of the YouTube comments and the views and everything like that, dude, for all the hate that this series gets, nobody cares about it, this, and this, fucking YouTube numbers are popping. Like, Don, all the content you put together did great views. And then if you just go look up WSX Vancouver stuff, trying to find like a race recap like I was trying to find today, yes, there's some pirated ones that are out there. For a race series that nobody cares about, one moto's getting 100,000 clicks. 100,000 views, you know what I mean? There's six, eight motos that you got to do with the super final that's in there too. There's interest in this. Like, there definitely is something that people want to see. They have a global sports package with like
Interest
some of
is
the
number
biggest partners.
three and number one for sure.
Yeah. And I mean, that's what you wanted.
Yeah, it's just so. You know what I will say is they have those autograph signings outside the stadium, and you know, it's from this time to this time. Dude, Kenny stayed out there, like the whole row of tables was empty. Posters and pens and stuff. Kenny stayed out there and signed autographs till the last person was pumped, you know? And I think, I don't know, is Vancouver a big motocross mecca? I mean, I don't think so. But for people to get to see a guy like Eli and Kenny in person there, pretty big deal.
Yeah, I mean, I heard that the stadium holds what 50 something thousand or something like that. And he said there was, I think 20 something thousand people there or something like that, from
Yeah.
what I heard. Which I mean, it's still good, right? I mean, that's a huge stadium there, right? I know the ends aren't full, but like the middle areas of the stadium seemed like they were packed.
Yeah. I was
So,
pumped because I, you know, because of the three hamster cages we got to shoot from, I said, yeah, I shot in the stands. I walked around instead. I had no problem getting around. I enjoyed the crowd that size. Yeah.
did you talk much to any fans? Like, I wonder, was there any Americans that you ran into? Did people from Washington drive up and
Yeah,
whatnot?
quite a bit. I guess Swapmoto Live is kind of popular in Canada. I got a lot of are you
It's
Swapmoto?
because they know how much you love their Whistler bike park.
Yeah, I got some of those comments. Oh, you going to Whistler after this? Well, no, it's closed. Damn it. What
Yeah,
else
yeah.
went there?
I mean, dude, what about Chiz's start, dude, on the Suzuki?
Okay, I was like, Chiz, why are you on a 250, dude? And he goes, oh, well, you know, there's two 250s, two 450s, and Colt and I are each arguing our case. And I was saying, look at Colt, he's 250 Supercross champ. He should ride the Super 250, but you know, he ended up getting off. But dude, Chiz like hole shot a couple races, right? He was
Yeah, I
like,
know, that was awesome.
Is that
he's
their,
fast.
do we know if that's their own engine spec or is that like an old Bar X spec or something?
He says it's not even the good 250. He says it's not the
Really?
Bar X spec. He's like, it's not
Oh, the
even
Bar
good
X
enough.
spec's a good 250 then. Okay.
Yeah, he's on like, it was really fast. He goes, I had a lot of fun. But it was cool watching him out there on that thing. He ain't the smallest guy for sure.
Yeah.
But McElrath was solid. It's funny because when he got up front, I was like, oh, dude, remember how gnarly he was on a 250 when he was on Star? I mean, so he knows how to go fast on a 250 for sure, but like I think the second race I saw Ants. I was pissed because I was setting something on my camera and I was watching the race. Oh, because I shot Shane leading, and then I was looking at it, see how it looked, and then I looked back and I saw Matt or Max just bonk that jump and go to the bars and break
I
his
hit
leg
false
up.
neutral or something.
Yeah, but yeah, he definitely made some mistakes.
He's had a rough go at the off-season stuff. Like between this and Nations, he's had some falls, a lot of falls lately.
Yeah. So he was, I guess, wild card, right? Because he's only doing this one. He said he wanted to just come and get at least one race with the number one plate on. But it looks like Shane is in driver's seat, yeah.
Yeah, I
Yes.
was obviously I was impressed with Shane, but dude, Lopes, especially that last race, Lopes got up there and he didn't have a good start at all. So it's good to see
Yeah.
him have speed and whatnot, especially with the issues he's been dealing with. And he was a little wary, I know, about racing Supercross with that. I think because the whoops are maybe harder to hold on to. But yeah, he looked good too, I thought.
Yeah, he said his hand did okay. Like the whole Botox arm pump thing. I asked him how it was after the race, and he said it got a little numb there, but it was okay for the most part. But I thought Cody Shock looked really good for
He was racy and loose, racy
yeah.
and loose. But I mean, dude, he was, you could tell that he really wants to do good this series. You know, I think that this, you know, him doing these, preseason races, it's only going to help him, you know, going into next year, right? I think Cody is very, very close to making that next step. I think like he's right on the cusp, you know, like 5, 6, 7 guy, you know, in East Coast Supercross, but like maybe doing some of these off-season races, getting more comfortable racing these guys with bigger names, you know. I think that next year, I mean, I think that there's no reason why he shouldn't be a podium guy if he keeps on the, you know, trajectory that he is, you know. It's awesome to see, you know, like being around Cody, you know. I mean, we were neighbors there for a few years, in Temecula, just seeing the growth, you know, of him and everything that he's gone through and everything. Yeah, it's awesome to see, you know. Personally, I think that if he hadn't have signed this 3-year deal with Club MX, dude, I mean, who knows? He might have gotten a call from Bobby at some point, you know. So
I think that's pretty cool too that club let him use his bike for this WSX thing.
yeah, you know,
Yeah.
I thought that he was going to be an O'Neill there for a little bit, but you know, he's a big FXR guy, you know, which, you know, super understandable, all that stuff. But yeah, I'm stoked for Cody.
Yeah. So let's talk about the Rick Ware Racing kits.
I don't think it was
Yeah.
that bad, dude. I don't I
Dude, the white helmets.
The white helmets. I mean, you got to think too, like whenever you're dealing with a very, very corporate, huge company like this, right? Everything's got to be approved, all of it. So, you know, going in the like, hey, this is the jersey that we approve. I'm like, okay, well, that's the last year's model, I feel like, right? So you guys noticed that we had the jerseys, but we didn't have the red pants, you know, which the black pants, it goes well with it, but that was the only jersey that Arby's approved, apparently. But I thought it looks great. All that stuff. We're gonna do some modifications to the jerseys. I think the jerseys were a little big, in my opinion. But other than that, like I think it was awesome. You know, I think it's always good whenever we have companies like this in our sport. You know, and it's cool seeing the guys, you know, get behind it and, you know, like, hey, you know, we got the meats. You know, like we brought our A game, which was super cool. You know, I mean, I understand, you know, like with the white helmets and stuff like that, they got a little bit of hate, but I think that this team should get a little bit of praise because, you know, it's an outside sponsor. It's something cool for our sport. You know, I think that what the Rick Ware team is doing, I think it's awesome, you
Yeah,
know.
I didn't even hate the white helmets, to be honest. The only thing I hated was the random green plastics on Oldenburg's bike.
Yeah, I think it was like an airbox or something.
Airbox and mud flap, I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yo, what kind of vendetta did Tanti have against the cardboard boxes? Because that man was just
Oh
blowing through them.
yeah. Yeah. And it was weird. Did you guys notice that like the covers that they had on the boxes were getting caught up in their wheels super easily?
Yeah, I was wondering what type of material they were, if they were like
It's almost like,
the or
yeah.
something else.
Would you guys rather have the sketchiness of the tough block or the sketchiness of like, hey, I can run over this box, not crash, but then not know that I have this thing stuck in my wheel and then endo over a triple?
Well, they could do not covered tough blocks. Like I know, like Zing, Bob Zing, they
Yeah,
make
they
those
make the
stasic printed boxes and whatnot. They could have done that, which that
yeah.
would eliminate that issue.
Eli said that the cardboard's 100 times better than a sponge block because you can land on them and not eat shit.
Yeah.
And the cardboard thing's been going on for a while. Like even the Australian series, like where this came from was the Aussie guys doing this when they took World Supercross on the road and everybody like criticized it, but that's what the Aussie series is still doing. Because if you watch the practice videos from the series down there's no tough blocks on the track at the time because they got to save them for later in the day so nobody blows through anything.
Yeah.
Gosh.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd if there's cardboard boxes in Supercross next year, I'd buy stock in cardboard, especially if there's a guy like me racing, because I would hit every single one of them.
Hey, not like this isn't a criticism, but Don, I do have this question from watching it today. Not a lot of sponsors, really, right? Like it was a motorcycle shop that had a sponsor, and then there was the FIM and the WSX, like tough block banners that were out there in a Caterpillar one, but that was really it. It wasn't like the overboard of like Progressive this, Monster this, Honda this.
Yeah, it was mostly the orange ones that just said WSX, but again, like
But
I didn't spend any time on the track itself, so.
I do know that, which I got a text from someone, I'm not sure, but there was, like, I don't know if it was Canadian Federation or the City of Vancouver or whatever, but they did get some money from some type of federation. Anton, I don't know if you
It's the city of Vancouver because then
can.
Perth's Western Australia Tourism Board has the same thing. And then Ethara is like the tourism board for Abu Dhabi. So all three of those are pretty big into that. And they've even said, like, Tom Burwell's, I think the guy's name. I have, like, Don, even the fact that you went, like, I have not had any contact with any person on like a management level of what this is, but they've done a pretty good job of getting like interviews with this guy in Forbes and other things that are out there. And he had said too, like, we really are going to lean into tourism things, like just like all the other motorcycle series do. Like we're as Supercross, they're the only one aside from the Utah Sports Commission that doesn't have a local tourism board paying sponsorship money. So they're trying to do that. And then they want to take it up to like a seven race series pretty soon within the next 2 years.
Yeah, that's super cool that they're pulling money from, or they're getting money from these federations and from these styles. I mean, and it's quite a bit of money, right? From my
So
understanding.
this was something like last week when we were talking about the whole what's like a potential outside sponsor thing that you would want to go see. Sports tourism right now is like one of the biggest things. I think I might have even mentioned it back then too. So this all just works hand in hand. You want people to come to Vancouver. Like, Don, how many times have you been to Vancouver in the last 3 years and you find a little new neighborhood or a new this or a new that? And that's what they want. They want to find that like 25 to like 40 demo that's got some money and is willing to go spend and get out there. And like that's why all these cities and countries are paying the money to get people to come here. There's like tens of billions of dollars in sports tourism right now to be made, and everybody wants their slice of
I'm outside that demo, but I love Vancouver. Well, I love Whistler. You're active and affluent. Not
You
crazy.
have that's exactly what they want, affluency and activity.
All right, that's enough WSX. Let's take a break, hear from our sponsors.
MotoCuts MX has the best custom graphics in the game. With their leading-edge design and quality material, MotoCuts MX does not miss. Do your best to look the best and order a new set of custom graphics now on MotoCutsMX.com.
X-Brand Goggles was launched in 2008, and over the past two decades, they've earned a reputation as one of the elite eyewear choices in our sport. The newest offering, the Lucid Goggle, features an XDO injection-molded lens for exceptional optical clarity, as well as superior protection against the massive roost that modern-day four-stroke bikes throw. At Swapmoto Live, we love the Lucid Goggle for its huge field of vision. Check them out at xbrand.com. That's eksbrand.com. If you're on the West Coast and you're looking for a one-stop shop, you need to visit the guys at STR Motorsports, formerly known as Shock Therapy Racing. With over 30 years of experience, your bike will be in great hands. Whether you're looking for a custom performance suspension revalve or just a basic rebuild, they've got you covered. STR also offers motor building services. Whether you need a stock engine rebuilt or a full-blown race motor, they're the place to go. Conveniently located in Wildomar, California, they're very close to Lake Elsinore and Paris Raceway. Additionally, they maintain a full stock of oils, tires, and tubes. They can get pretty much anything you need. Check them out at shocktherapysuspension.com. ASV Inventions supports the sport of motocross with innovative products like the original unbreakable folding lever, on-the-fly adjustable clutch purchases, rotator front brake clamps, Y-handle tools, and more.
ASV is also a distributor of products like ODI Grips and the innovative Gate King tailgate adjuster. They're also a proud sponsor of the Swapmoto Race Series and their track side at each and every event. Their amateur racer support program is open year-round, and you can apply for support at hookit.com. Learn more about ASV products at asvinventions.com.
Did you know that in addition to being some of the coolest people on motocross, the crew at WUSA are the official importers of Talon, Kite, and Edge hubs, as well as the leading resource for DID and Excel rims. Through the years, we've tested plenty of aftermarket wheels, and the wheel building crew at WUSA can't be beat. WUSA is the source for all things associated with wheels, including sprockets, spoke wrenches, tire irons, and more. Mention Swapmoto Live when ordering anything from WUSA and get a nice little discount too. Check them out at WUSA.com.
Hey guys, it's Ryan Villapoto. Now that I'm living the retired life and not bound to factory team sponsors, I'm able to choose my partners when it comes to building my bikes. I choose Backyard Designs to create my motorcycle graphics because they do a great job. Their kits look great, go on easy, and last long.
Backyard Design has the most comprehensive and user-friendly graphic website in the sport. Use the discount code SWAPMOTO at checkout for a discount at backyarddesignsusa.com.
G'day guys, this is 9-time X Games gold medalist Jared McNeil. Off the motocross bike, I spend plenty of time cross-training on my intense mountain bike. From the super fast and efficient Sniper cross country bike to the aggressive Primer and Tracer trail bikes, or even the amazing Taser e-bike. Every intense is designed and developed in the United States and built to the highest standards. A life on two wheels certainly includes pedals too. So give the crew at intensecycles.com a look.
What's up? This is Christian Craig. As a motocross racer, being in top physical shape is a must, and my favorite way to train is cycling. And whether it's road biking or mountain biking, I rely on Roy Cyclery to keep my bikes in perfect running order.
Roy Cyclery has been servicing Old Town Upland, California since 1962. Mention the Swapmoto Live podcast for additional discounts in the show.
Guts Racing, the leaders in seat technology. Go to gutsracing.com today and design your custom seat cover. We try to ship all custom seat covers within 36 business hours. We also offer free shipping to the lower 48 states. Once again, that's gutsracing.com.
Over the past 40 years, EVS Sports has established themselves as the leaders in innovation and technology when it comes to designing protection gear for today's motocross riders. Athletes like RJ Hampshire, Kyle Chisholm, Axel Hodges, and Travis Pastrana all wear EVS when they race, ride, or whatever Travis decides to do that day. Check out EVS-sports.com to gear up like the pros.
Welcome back to the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. The other big occurrence this weekend was Anton went racing in the woods
at Ironman
GNCC. I wasn't sure if he went or not though, because I didn't see anything on our Instagram.
Yeah, it was fucking chaos. It was chaos. Like, that many people that are all around all the places. And then, like, when we got there on Saturday afternoon to, like, oh, okay, we're going to this, isn't it? Nobody's there. Everybody's running around. Everybody's watching the four-wheeler races that are there. And then the amateur morning classes are so popular at that race that there's two races. There's an 8 a.m. and a 10 a.m. And usually there's just one race in the morning. There was, like, 750 people on the track during my moto. So just even trying to get, like, to the right spot at the right time, getting parked, all that stuff. Like, we pulled up to the track at 7 o'clock in the morning and we're still on a line. I was like, fuck, dude, we're in for one. But then if you go see all the stuff that's out there, like, dude, it's unbelievable. Like, to go see a GNCC and Megan had never seen one before. And she's like, dude, this is like day in the dirt times five. I'm like, yeah, they did it 13 times this year. And that many people come and you see how many motorhomes are out there and just everybody that's into it. Whole town of Crawfordsville is taken over by it. The people that go to ride those things is way, way, way different than the same crowd of people that comes to the national and all that stuff. So it was intense. And it was just cool to see how important that the GNCC off-road stuff has gotten in the last few years. Because you remember at Transworld, like, we started putting together the trail riding stuff more and more. And that's as that was coming on, because it was just like a completely untalked about demo, you know, even though Big Six stuff and Hare and Hound, all that does well, we just had never given it coverage. But when you see how many bikes are out there, how many people buy the stuff, how many people are going to have to go do it more and more, like, so many motorcycle shops this week are going to be doing well because of all the people that needed new parts after what they did this weekend, and then just all the OEM support that's out there. Yamaha has been really serious about it. Kawi's gotten serious about it in the last few years. But KTM, the KTM group is definitely the barometer that everybody else is judged against because they own that category for sure.
Did you get any footage of Villopoto on a quad?
I did not.
There is some out there, and it is rough.
They had a twist throttle. So like there's two different, like, you know, thumb throttle or twist throttle. And so then you got to hear everybody talk about what was better, thumb or twist. Da, da, da. So that was interesting. Dude, there's no way I would want to ride. And I'm not trying to hate on the couch people, but how you would get through the woods on one of those things and then somebody bumping you from behind and how it would just like rip your handlebars out of your hands. I don't even know how they made it through some of the spots that we were going through on four wheels because there was no room for two wheels to go through.
I tried to ride a quad at my little night track at home in Tennessee, and dude, it is very, very tough to ride a four wheeler. Like, props to those guys, like, they do that stuff, but like, I'm out, just keep me on two, like, lose a couple wheels and we're good. But
you,
dude, Don,
you want to know what popular four wheeler still super popular? The Honda 250R. Still seeing some of those 80s sure. bikes rolling through the pits. Still quite a few of them.
Any Quadzilla 500s?
Ooh. Didn't see any of those.
What about some Banshees? Or do we have all those?
Didn't see any of those. I think all those are at Glamis getting ready for Thanksgiving and Halloween.
Oh, yeah. They're getting ready.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. There's a few Banshees out there, like Tennessee area, but I don't know about Indy. They get those Banshees out there in those soybean fields, dude, and they let them things rip, brother.
Those things would be sick in the hill climbs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Hearing a Banshee come up Ironman Hill would probably be pretty sick. Bro, but the last place on earth that I want to be is a spectator on Ironman Hill. Like, I'm good.
Yeah.
The dust out there wasn't unreal. So we haven't really had a lot of rain in the Midwest lately. And like St. Louis is one of the only areas that's not in a drought like everybody else is around us. But like, you know, campfire stuff like that is huge for the GNCC, but they were under a burn control warning, so no one was allowed to have campfires. But the amount of dust that was out there through the woods, like you would see somebody just hit a bump and then just poof, and you don't see anything. Like, you was basically riding blind through the whole track.
Not bad.
I was watching some videos just like on Instagram from like Phil Nicoletti and like those guys, and dude, it did seem very, very dry, you know? How long was the lap time for you, Anton? And like was it fun? Would you do it again? Like,
oh yeah, definitely it was fun. I'd love to do it again. I'm glad that Phil lapped me in the last like 2 miles. So I didn't get like completely decimated. I finished like 335 out of 750, 722, whatever it was. So like right mid pack. So that's not too bad. But it was fun. Dude, Phil was ripping. I was waiting for like him, RV, Marvin, all these guys to come flying by me, but then Phil only got me in the last like few minutes. So that was nice. I think
Phil lapped you, but you guys, there's 775 people in the industry class?
No, 775 people in the moto, but row back. Yeah.
Okay,
industry class was probably like 20 people.
And so what?
He was in like sportsman. He was in like sportsman A.
And he won the whole thing.
I got second. Some other off-road guy that I didn't know won.
Oh, okay, okay.
But he got third. Phil got third overall.
Was this just like a fun thing for him, or is this the after racing career that he's not exposed?
I don't know. I don't think that like he's gonna fully be invested in that because he and I were talking a little bit this morning. He's like, that shit was insane. Like, that was seeing God coming through the dust and everything. He could definitely have fun at it because people were really, really I think people were more happy to see him or just as happy to see him as they were to see RV and Marvin. Like, people love RV and Marvin. Like, they're excited for that. But Phil just has that, like, cult status around him right now where you want to see Phil. You want to hang out with him. But, yo, he was ripping. He was on a Husky. It wasn't factory looking. Like, it didn't have Rockstar logos and all the other stuff on it. It had, like, the Heritage Edition kit with the blue and yellow stripes. It looked good. And then when he went passing me, I was like, fuck, that was Phil. Damn, he looked good. He looked really good.
Yeah.
I never saw RV, but RV was on a 125X. So the two stroke that Yamaha makes. And then Marvin was on the same bike I was on, that new factory edition 350. But it sounds like Marvin had a crash on the first lap and then he bounced out. He hit his leg pretty hard. But I don't think Marvin was having a great time out there through all of it. It didn't. I was like, yo, did you think that like when you went faster, it went smoother? And just the typical Marvin look, like, no, No, big eyes.
No.
No.
There's no. Yeah.
No.
And like we know Marv. Like Marv wants to have fun. Marv loves to race, loves to ride and everything. But Marv is competitive. Like he wants to win. You can definitely tell even whenever he shoots up to Glen Helen, you know, and he's on his two stroke, he wants to win. Mm-hmm. You know? And yeah, bummer that he crashed out, but he did look good, you know. So
people were really, really excited to see Marvin too. Just like really? The respect that he has. Yeah. For that. Like just, hey man, like we've seen, especially Marvin and Ironman, like he has a good history at that track. It's, you know, pretty up and down, but all those people know him and all those people were excited, like just sitting under the KTM truck. I saw a lot of people come over and just want to tell him how happy they were that he made the effort to come see it.
That's cool. That's cool.
Yeah.
I need to get back out and do another GNCC, man. My first
one that I did. Attitude.
A woods race? There ain't no woods in
no works race.
Works race? Ah,
it's like the hardest.
The discipline is so much different. Like it's so much different. Like works to GNCC. Works is more like high pace. I feel mm-hmm. to where woods. It's more like yeah, you're high pace, but you're going through trees. You're banking off of trees, like you said, Anton. Like you're going through dust, all that stuff. Yeah. I don't know which one I would like better. I don't know. I'd like to try it again, though.
I don't know. I rode at Randy Hawkins' ranch on, I think it was the YZ250X. And, dude, those tree roots, I crashed so many times because my friend would just wash out in them. So, like, I'd rather have dust, I think.
Well, that was the fucking problem, though, is because the dust is covering the tree roots, so you don't see them. And then you're like, oh, I'm good. And then, bam, tree roots. And then you're just like.
Yeah, but a wet tree root. Is what I'm talking about, dude.
Yeah.
How many times did you break over, Anton?
I fell three times. And then, but I only fell three times. I probably stalled at like a dozen. So I'm so glad that it had an electric starter and it just kept firing up. But then like towards the end of like, okay, first lap, A-Ray, like you said, where you saw red when that guy was jacking with you when you were riding at LACR yesterday. In the middle of my lap, like I'm halfway through, the first lap is just pandemonium because you don't know what's happening. Like I hadn't seen the track. First time I'd ridden the bike was the first lap of that race. And that 350 rips, man, because third gear, you just could leave it in that the whole way around. But then whenever you got on the gas, it wanted to lift the front end up because it's just got great, great power and great torque and everything. But going down this really steep off camber, and then there was a hard right at the bottom of it. Some guy came over, chopped my front end, and then took me down. And I just stood up and gave him a nice big finger in front of everybody. So like that was the only moment of frustration. And then that broke the clamp for my master cylinder up on the front brake lever on the handlebar. So I rode the whole first lap with the front brake like moving like that. And then found a guy with a 8mm T handle real quick, and then he tightened it up. And so then that made the other laps not too bad. But yeah, only went down a couple times, so it wasn't terrible. Like no death-defying moments. I didn't like have to ghost ride the bike up the tree or anything like that.
How did you find a guy in the crowd with an 8mm T hand?
Not
dude,
in.
You'd be surprised. You would be surprised.
You would be blown away. But this was like everybody's got a pit. But then for the amateur class, it's not like the pro pit where there's a designated pit lane. So like, hey, just wherever your guy is out with, like, hey, I'm gonna be over here. This and this. As I was coming through in the field section, so you could look up and like look around, I saw a guy with a trailer, and there was a KTM in the back of the trailer, and then he was prepping everything. And I'm like, oh, hey, that guy, I know that guy's got something. So I just wheeled over and I rev real quick, and they came running out. They're like, what's wrong? I'm like, I just need a T-handle. Like, can you tighten this up? And they dialed me in, and then I took back off again. So shout out to those people. The Woods people are great. I do have to say, like, everybody's super, super helpful. Even the joke about, like, you'd have to be a madman to want to stand in the middle of that track. But, like, if you do get stuck, somebody's going to come run over and help you pick your bike up out of the tree root or out of the dust or direct you to another line. So that part is cool.
Being that dusty and stuff, there was still a water crossing, right? Because I saw a video of Villa. Mm-hmm. Splashing through one. Now was it did it get bigger during the race? Because that's what happened to me at High Point. I came through the first lap leading. We lead through this little stream. And the second lap I came around, the people that were all by the stream dammed it up and it was like 5 feet deep and I went over the bars. And
no.
But they picked me up, turned my bike upside down, started it, put me back on it and took me off. But they just wanted to see me go over the bars, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So was it like that kind? Were they damming up the stream, making it bigger?
So I did this race for the first time in 21 when it was that like hellacious, like mud year. And so I'm not even gonna lie. When I was sitting on the starting line for that race that day, I was like, "Yo, it's stupid. You better not fall on the water, and like, you're gonna drown if you do." But it was so dry at this one now. Like every time you splash through it, it just got drier and drier. So the few little water crossings that we did have, they just got a little bit more choppy. But it's never like they got crazy. It's not like how like there's this one at Snowshoe called Howard's Hole where everybody's at, and that's like the full pandemonium, almost Baja level sabotage and booby trap area. But it was nothing like that at this one. If anything, how dry it was, if the water got splashed out, it just made it better and better. Last night, though, as we were driving home, I was thinking about it. I'm honestly probably kind of glad that it was dusty over being really wet, or even like rain the night before or something like that. Because I don't think I would have had as much fun if it was riding ruts all the way around there. There were still ruts that got carved into like the super hard packed dirt that's dry. But if it was just a 15-mile slot car ride around there, that would have been terrible.
Yeah. What do you got? I mean, this is a little different topic or whatever, but I mean, you guys have been on Instagram today. What do you guys think about the new that fly kit that they got that the boys over there did for Trump?
What do you
I
mean?
saw helmets, right?
I didn't see
Yeah, it was
it.
like helmets and gear. They made like a fly did like a whole like gear thing for Eric Trump, I think, or somebody.
Oh, really? Oh, I did
I
see
thought
that.
they painted like a bunch of helmets for him.
Why
Yeah,
did
but I believe
this need 20
they did
helmets?
some gear and everything too.
Back at Dallas SMX race, they did that gear that RJ had, so I bet that they put that into production.
Yeah.
Oh, really? You think so?
Shit's gonna sell.
Oh,
Like
that'd be
fucking
insane.
people are gonna
Yeah.
buy it, so.
That's true.
Yeah.
Hey, who painted those helmets, Ray? Are you on there right now?
Yeah, one second.
Schultz design.
Schultz did those?
Schultz
Schultz,
design.
yeah,
Wow.
for Eric Trump.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't know. Something cool, something different. Yeah.
Somehow Mike at Roy's knows someone that's close to Eric, and they want
Yeah.
to fly me out there to test his bike.
The one that like the club guys built?
I guess, I don't know. The one that had
Yeah.
W wheels on it.
Oh,
Yeah.
okay. I
thought it was it. For some reason, when I was told about it, I thought it was gonna be in California. I'm like, yeah, we'll do something. And I found out I had to fly to Florida or something. I was like, ain't happening.
Anyways, what else is going on in the world?
I pulled after criticizing you for going to the track last weekend without looking to see if there's a race going on. I did the exact same thing on Friday and pulled up to Fox Raceway and wondered why the hell there was 1,500 RVs and trailers. So
See, it's easy to do. Hey, look at the
that
calendar,
was. Yo, dog,
Chase.
call
Look at the
before you
calendar
haul.
next time, Chase.
Yep. My bad. My bad.
What was race
Did you
number
not
one?
line up and race?
No, it was my.
Oh.
It was the fall classic.
But you still got to ride though, right? It wasn't like it was just a race practice day, or was it?
It
What was
was the main course was for racing, so they had like big bike, small bike, 10-minute sessions, whatever. So we got stuck on the vet track, but it's okay. It's
Yeah.
all right.
You got an Insta banger though.
I got an Insta banger, yeah. It was funny.
What is that?
I got to bring my friend riding for the first time in a while. And he comes back to the truck. He's like, dude, I just had the gnarliest 15-minute battle with a kid on a 65.
That's awesome.
Damn.
Yeah. I like how your graphics match your helmet, match your gear, match your boots, like
Yeah.
everything's
Bar
just all
pad.
synchronized.
Dude,
Yeah.
the graphics and
Yeah.
the helmet look sick together.
Yeah, the style. Heck yeah.
So are
Anyway.
you going to bring that bike down to Race Tech this week, or are you going to just it with like
I would
90?
like to. Yeah. I would really like to bring it down to Race Tech. I just gotta find a day I mean a day that I can get away and get it down there. It's kind of tough right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, speaking of Race Tech and our buddy Checkers, what do you know about this big video game
Dude.
that dropped? I mean, it was funny because everyone was like dropping that thing with the countdown. And I was like, even though I knew about that beforehand, it caught me off guard. I'm like, what is that? Is that a new Maxxis tire or something? Because it's an orange logo. It looked kind of like the M, but I'm not a gamer guy. So, like,
I am. I'm very stoked because this when I banged up my collarbone and my liver and stuff, I was down for a while. So I caved in and got this dirt bike game with some friends on a PC and all that. And everyone involved in that current game that makes it cool and does like the replica tracks every week and whatnot is involved with checkers in this new game. So it's going to be,
wow.
Yeah. It's like looking at the lineup of who's involved in this motocross, the game, it's unreal. Like the fact that they're all working together, it's pretty exciting for that whole community. And I'm not much of a gamer either, but I know really since the motocross versus ATV thing went south, yeah, Supercross, the game and whatnot, has tried to make a comeback, but it just wasn't really liked by people. So there's definitely a hole and been a hole there for a while. So it's cool to see that there's something coming.
So this is a cool thing about the game?
Huh?
It's a PC only thing?
No, that's the other crazy thing. This is going to be like cross-platform. So they're going to have the new PlayStation, new Xbox, and PC, and you're supposed to be able to play with each other, which is crazy. And that's like, this is the first of that for a motocross game.
Huh. Yeah. Dude, I have a, when we did a movie with Joe Shimoda and Carson Mumford years and years ago when they're amateurs. Mm-hmm. So I spent a bunch of time with Joe, and I was at his house, and he had some freaking what's that?
Yeah, what was that called? Gosh darn it.
Game called where you put the thing on and you're like zombies and you're killing people and stuff.
Well, he had like a VR headset, but I think he was playing like Call of Duty or something. Yeah.
No, it wasn't Call of Duty. It was like the zombie game. Like,
there's zombies in Call of Duty.
Yeah, zombies. No, it wasn't Call of Duty though. It was something else. Anyway, I played at his house and it was like so sick. I went home and I bought a PlayStation. I bought that game and everything, and I was playing it. And I got to a point where I couldn't like figure one thing out. I'm all, bah! I haven't turned it on since. But I played it like 5 hours a night, every night for like 2 weeks. Until that point, but I'm like, hey, I still have one of those like PlayStation things. Maybe this game, yeah. It's probably old now.
Maybe. Yeah, you might be like 4 or 5 generations behind, but maybe.
Yeah, so this is shit. When were we still on Factory Connection Amateur?
This was 2018.
That was 2018?
I think so, yeah.
So that was the current PlayStation then. So how many have come out since then?
Probably.
I think it was 5.
I don't know. I have no idea. I don't know.
So yeah.
Damn.
The cool thing about this video game, and like you alluded to it, Chase, is that there's been the drop off since the MX versus ATV stuff. Checkers was part of MX versus ATV at the like heyday. So he knows like what it takes to make a good game, and so do all those guys that are around him. And then now, like even back to the Motocross Madness stuff that was on Microsoft back in like 98. So Chase, like you weren't playing with computer games back then, but to like the same but like same thing, like all that same, like Ron was the man. Like you could just get on Ron Swarm and find out where the tracks or the skins and all that stuff were. So to see same idea has been there, and then when they went to the console route and then to bring it back to the computers and to see all the same people still have the passion they have for it is tight.
Yeah.
Is Ron Cotta still doing game stuff? I'm sure he is, right?
I thought so.
I don't know. I'm a Excite Bike guy. I'll fuck you guys up on that.
I'm not good at games, dude. I'm horrible. Like I tried to get into it just because like my friends were playing. I'm like, yo, like I'll get on the headset. I'll talk to like Heart Raft and all the boys and whatever. I just run and hide. I'm just like the worst video gamer ever. I don't know. I just suck at them all. Yeah. I don't know. It looks fun.
Yeah. All right. I think we wrap this episode up. I got a few things to write. So, guys, thanks for checking out the Kickstart podcast presented by Pro Taper. We'll talk to you next week.
Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, ProTaper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more.